All right, let's get started. Welcome to the workshop, Production Ready Data Science with Python and Luigi. So my name is Mark. I'm working at Codecentric as a whatever data guy, doing a bit of data science, a bit of data engineering, and a bit of software engineering. And I want to talk a little bit today about interactive data science, interactive model development, and how we can basically transform the development workflow or transform a model that we interactively developed into a production-ready pipeline and a production-ready model, basically. So overall, what we are doing is building workflows in Luigi. That's what you see here. So we see how can we use the nice story that the data scientist created using his model. How can we basically streamline all the development that he did here? How can we version different models? How can we version configurations and so on? And basically create models automatically. We will utilize Spotify Luigi, a workflow framework in Python. You will hear a little bit more about that later. Of course, we use Python. And so the problem that we try to solve today and where we are model build is we want to distinguish between limes and bananas in images. All the code is the slides, you have Jupyter notebooks, they are all in a GitHub repository. I will add them tomorrow. I will add the link to my abstract in the PyData, on the PyData website. I just have to clean it up a little bit, to be honest. Okay, let's start. So we want to build a model first. And to see the full pane and to see where are the small little glimpses and the small little parts when we build a model, to see what kind of parts are important to get production ready or not, we start building the model interactively right now. So, okay, we got the task. We have a set of images. We need to distinguish what are limes, what are bananas. It's important. It has to be in production soon. And we are the data scientist that gets this fruitful task. What would we do? First of all, somewhere we need to get the data set. Okay. I prepared a little bit here. This is the data set from the Tutti Frutti Kaggle competition. It just stripped down to two classes, limes and bananas. To make it a little bit harder, I created two data sets. So the first data set, it got just half of the training data, and the second data set, it got the full training data. It's just a great way to simulate how can we version our data sets, how can we improve models, how can we generate new models when we have more data, and how can we basically deploy also for different versions. All right, so what are we doing here? The first thing that we are doing is we do some system commands. So we create our directory, whatever data set, and here the important part, we run a curl to download the data set that we think is currently the newest one. It's the version 1. And of course, we unzip it. Ignore a little bit this text here. It's just the output. What we see is, all right, let's look a little bit into the data set. And what we see is how cool. We have two classes. We have bananas and lemons. So exactly what we wanted. The easy part. I mean, we do that every day. Just one. Could you start the clock? Probably, someone. If not, it's okay. Just it started. Awesome. Thanks. All right. Okay. We got the data. We want to train our model. So the next thing, what every good data scientist does, is let's do some exploratory analysis. So let's see how our data set looks like. We are using Keras here. And let me give you some small hints how that works. At first, we need some assumptions. So I know in our data set, our image is 100 times 100 pixels large, and they are RGB. The next thing is we define where lies our train data and where lies our testing data. So far, so good. Pretty standardized way of handling large data sets. In Keras, the next thing that you can do, you build so-called image data generators. So if you try, for example, the former MNIST example or eMNIST from Google, what you often see is you load the data set with a simple command, and it just runs through. You can do this as long as the data set is quite small. As soon as you start to have gigabytes of data or terabytes of data for training, you cannot load everything in memory anymore. Okay? Keras has a nice solution for this. All the imports are hidden here on the slides. But Keras has a nice solution for this, the image data generator. Right. So let's use this. And the first thing that we see here, we also can put some options in. We only have one option. There is way more. The good thing is, if we look at the data, we don't need so much options anymore. Give me just 1 second to show you what I mean. So let's look here. These are all our elements. And the cool thing is the data is already distorted somehow. So we have lemons in different angles. We have photos from different angles, different kinds of brightness, and so on and so on. That's just the reason that we can keep our image data generator quite simple, because we don't have to distort, we don't have to augment the data anymore. But this is here everything for image pre-processing that should be done here. Okay. So to load the data and create an actual generator, we do the flow from directory. So image, gen train, flow from directory. And what happens is Keras basically loads batch by batch in a Python generator. And you can directly feed this generator into the fit function afterwards. The great thing is you only have, well, here we don't have any parameter for batch size, so we will always have at max 32 images per batch per calculation in memory, and the rest is still on the hard disk. So that makes it quite easy. Cool. Just keep it in mind because we need a bit of it. Oh, we have it here. We have the batch size here. Just keep it in mind because we come back later to this. All right. Next part. Some more exploratory analysis. Let's look at the classes. Fine. The classes look good. They are always already balanced. There's exactly the same amount of data per class. That's also important when we want to train our model. We see here a little bit more of the Keras API, meaning we gave the input shape to the generator, or better, for the pre-processing, meaning, cool, we know our images are 100 times 100, so we got the input shape. We have the classes here. You see that here. It's lemon and banana. We got the class indices. And with a little bit of NumPy magic, we can calculate also the amount of the distinct classes, data sets per class. So, cool. Okay. We go on. Let's look a little bit at the images. So this is the typical flow, I hope. Otherwise, I'm doing something wrong. So let's look a little bit at the pictures. Okay. So far, so good. Just exploratory analysis, just looking at something. We didn't build any model. So the first thing that comes into my mind when I have to do such task is deep learning is nice, but from my perspective, it's often overutilized. So what I try to do is build a nice, sleek baseline model because I think I'm smarter than every neural net. What does it mean? I try first to find something or to do something in a classification basis with OpenCV. Do you know OpenCV? Open Computer Vision? It's a, look at it. It's a great image processing library which is open source by Intel. and gives you probably everything you need, you ever need for computer vision. While reading a book about Keras, that was the guy, so François Chollet, he was giving me the idea. So before you start building any machine learning model, build something so easy where you can test against. Otherwise, how do I know if my first model is good or not? I will do this. And we built a baseline model to distinguish limes from bananas. Any idea what this model is doing? Yes. Yeah, it stands there. Nice. Sorry? Oh, sorry. The answer is we are basically checking if there is a circle on the image. So basically what the idea is, if we look back, the idea here is I got bananas. Okay, they are curved, but there's no circle in. And we got limes, and if I have a photo from a lime, there is always a circle on the image. It's not perfectly round, but it's always a circle. Cool. So that's the idea. There is a nice little function in OpenCV. It's called half circles. Don't ask about the parameters. I just randomly set them until I got a nice accuracy. But it works. It works on grayscale images. That's the other idea why I've chosen bananas against limes. Otherwise, everybody would come to the idea, oh, just look at the colors. Just get a histogram of colors and check if there are a lot of yellows and orange, for example. No, we don't want to do this. So we check for circles. And if we have a circle, fine, it's correct. If there's something wrong classified, we have a wrong one. In the end, our baseline model here gives us already an accuracy of 95%. So imagine you have this kind of task, and imagine your task is so narrowed down that you know there won't be anything more. Really think about a good baseline model. Don't go for all this training. You have models, you have different hyperparameters, and you have a million kinds of models somewhere in a folder on your local machine, and something in production happens, and someone asks, can you reproduce what you did? You said, oh, no. Happened a lot. I learned from it. So we have already a good baseline model. Of course, this kind of model is for image processing. It's not the best way. It only works if you see full limes. It only works if whatever bananas are not distorted, so whatsoever. It's a model which is maybe not very flexible. Also, as soon as you have a different kind of fruit, like an apple, you won't be able to use this model anymore. But for our purpose, it's right, because we want to test if we can bet better than 95%. Cool. So we got 95%. That's our bar. Our machine learning model has to be better. Let's see. Let's do deep learning. So we start our deep learning model. Did you all work with Keras before? Keras, TensorFlow, something like this? All right. So we go a little bit quick over it, but for the others, just a short, really, really short explanation. So first, in Keras, what you create is a model. So this is a sequential model. It's basically the standard feed-forward neural network that you can use everywhere. What we add to this model, and this is the trick in the whole computer vision tasks from Google and so on, we build a convolutional layer above it. So a neural net, everybody, I hope, knows it. It consists of many layers. Each layer has a certain set of neurons, and they get activated in certain times. So a convolutional layer is a little bit special because it's more like a filter. It's something that generates out of the image itself. It generates some kind of abstractions, and it feeds these abstractions into the next layer. Okay, so our net here, it consists of a convolutional layer. We don't need many filters. Four filters, meaning four different abstractions. These filters here, basically, they mean we got four kernels. A kernel is simply a matrix which is initialized randomly over a different size. or here it's a size of 2 times 2. And basically in the backpropagation, these matrices, the weights in these matrices get a little bit adjusted. But the idea is you have certain filters here. They are randomly initialized. They are a sliding window over the whole picture. And out of these, they generate new values to set pixels. So look at OpenCV, filter 2D, it's exactly the same. You can do it yourself, you can try it yourself. All right, so we have our convolutional layer here. We apply a max pooling, that means we try to get some data out and reduce, therefore, not dimensionality, yeah, dimensionality in one kind. We try to basically shrink down the image and only take the most important pixels in these abstractions. So max pooling. Another convolutional layer. We normalize the data right here. And we do that again. So in the end, we have a flatten. That means after what do we have, we have hundreds times 100 type 3. We add more filters here, 4, then we have all whatsoever. It just gets bigger and bigger. So in the end, we flatten the whole thing, and we have a lot of inputs to our dense layer. Our dense layer is basically the classical neural network that gives us back two results here, because we use categorical cross entropy, because we have two classes. And it says you have a certain probability for bananas and a certain probability for oranges. Don't wonder, I didn't use any binary cross entropy, because maybe we want to also distinguish between oranges, apples, so there are a lot of fruits, and we are already ready for multiple classes instead of binary classification. And we compile our model. That's the trick. Out of this basically Python representation with model.compile, internally it creates a TensorFlow graph with a TensorFlow backend. Okay, so we have our model. We train the model, and here we see more things that we basically have to adjust. We have epochs, we have steps per ecops, validation steps. Fine. Just keep it in mind. All right. And what we do is we do a model fit. We use the fit generator, important, because we have already a data generator. So fit generator uses a generator. So we are also ready for large data sets. We feed in the train data, all our stuff. And what we see here, we have with just 2 epochs and not so many data, we have around 75%. Fine. The model works somehow. Add a few epochs more, and it converges a little bit better. In our exploratory data analysis and interactive development, we leave it here, like this. It's a small data set, and we say 75%. It's not as good as the baseline, but fine. OK. Yeah, here, see the evaluation. With model.evaluate generator, you get basically here the loss and the accuracy again, if you don't want to rely on what Keras is printing out. Cool. It works. Now deploy it. And I've heard it so many times. You build something that works, and everybody was just saying, ah, cool. It's working, it just has to be deployed to production. That's all that I've heard. And I was already done. So when you ask your boss, you are already done. And he's assuming that you are already done. It just has to be deployed. OK. Maybe a bit for discussion. I got these points here from what's your ML test score? Have you heard from it? From Google? It's an awesome paper. So it's a bit of a mix between the Google paper and some stuff that I came across a lot of times. Be aware that Google is, well, they're probably 100 levels above most of that what most of the companies are doing. But still, I really like the ideas and from a software engineering perspective, and basically I started as a software engineer, for me it makes totally sense. To not get lost in a complexity that we don't need. Okay, so what's your ML test score? A rubric for ML production systems. Just do a quick look. They rate you in points. Fine. I don't want to be rated. These here are interesting. These are basically the points you should take care when you build a machine learning centric or data centric application. So, for example, test that the distributions of each feature match your expectations. It's basically exactly what you did in your interactive part. So you would get a point for it. So we got this for the data science parts, and the more we look here, tests for ML infrastructure, reproducibility, unit test your specification code, and so on and so on. So I can really, really recommend this paper to you. So for everybody who really wants to work in a ML environment seriously, more than just building some stories, doing your model, saying it's okay, and running away. So if you want to get at work in a real-life environment, try to come closer to that one. Okay, let's discuss a little bit. What do we have here? So, we have reproducible training. We did a lot right now. We downloaded some data. Awesome. And we have a Jupyter notebook. Yeah, it's made in a Jupyter notebook. It looks like a Jupyter notebook. There is a Jupyter notebook. But is it really reproducible? No, it isn't. We rely on data we download. We don't add any versions to our model. If we lose this notebook, no one ever knows what we did. So the only thing that is still existing from you is somewhere your Keras model on your S3 storage. So that's it. Okay. Validate quality. Well, we come closer to this. Now, this is why I did a small baseline model to validate quality. Interestingly, the paper from Google also mentions automation. So we can get a lot of points in do we validate our quality of the model and so on and so on and so on. But how much of it is automated? Or do you do it all by hand? Don't even think about it. Integration testing. It's another big part. Right now, our code is untestable. Neither integration testing works, or unit testing is a part of our data analysis. It shouldn't be, because we did an exploratory analysis. It's a proof of concept. We want to show that it works, but it's not meant to be deployed. Do we collect metrics? Yeah, maybe two, the loss and the accuracy. Nothing about how much data did we process. We got this information, but it's not collected somewhere. Nobody sees it. We don't even know how long it takes. If we have to train our model 10,000 times, no idea how long each time would take, really. We don't do logging. We have no alerting, because we are the alert. And it goes on and on. So do we do code reviews? No, when working on a Jupyter notebook, we do something. We hack something in. I don't think I've ever started a code review for a Jupyter notebook. Would even be fun if you try to review a Jupyter notebook inside GitLab or something. So no, it's also not really, really the thing. Do we test regressions? Meaning we need every old model and see if the new model performs better. And if we have some data identified which was basically not working, we need this kind of data and apply it to the new model and see if it always is working right. Also not. Continuous integration, continuous deployment. Does everybody know what this is? Yeah, we don't do that. Neither we do scheduling or monitoring. So no automation at all. All right. And we want to do something against this. And for this, Luigi comes a bit to the rescue. What is Luigi? So, Luigi overall helps us to stitch tasks together. So tasks are some kind of processing unit. And what we can do is we can build pipelines out of it. And Luigi pipelines are for long-running tasks. And the nice thing is Luigi basically, it gives us support for a variety of different technologies. So if I would ask what kind of tools are you using for data science? What kind of tools are you using to create models? Probably somebody over there would say, I use Spark, I use only Spark. Some other people would say, no, I started 10 years ago, I use MLlib and Hadoop. Others say, no, TensorFlow, easygoing, scikit-learn is way enough for everything that we are doing, and we use just simple Python scripting. So you have a lot of technologies over there. You have a lot of data sources everywhere. And the idea that Luigi was built with is, let's support these technologies. Let's create some framework around it to stitch pipelines out of it. And how do we compose these pipelines? Well, our workflow, it basically has tasks, as we said. Each task is resulting in a target. And basically, by requiring another task as a dependency, you basically require the target of this task. Huh, how does it look? Also, by the way, we also have parameters. We will see them. Okay, cool. How does it look like? Closely like this. A bit. Here, everything that's pink, you might have seen this here. Here are our targets. So everything that's pink, that's a target, and the target is the stitching part to other tasks. And in this example workflow, we see we have a simple Python script, so a simple Python task. We have a Hive task. I really like Luigi for in basically conjunction with Hadoop, because Hadoop is so big and complex, and every kind of service gets, connected to differently. You can use it in a different manner. You have different kind of services. So what you got here in Luigi, for example, for Apache Hive, everybody knows what Hive is? Really? It's basically a SQL layer above a distributed file system. So you put a schema over a distributed file system, namely HDFS, and basically every SQL query that you run, it gets translated into a MapReduce or a test job, which is cool because you have large data processing, you have scalable data processing, like SQL-like data processing, but really scalable, and most of the tools can talk to it. All right, so we got Hive tasks here. So if we can run Hive SQL queries, probably we have more tasks. We have, for example, MySQL tasks that let you talk to SQL databases. You have Spark tasks and so on. We look at one task in the end, another one. And the other big part that we got, they are the targets. So I talked about Hive. A target that's already written and is basically usable for you is this called Hive table target, which is also nice. It simply checks, is there a table for you? Done. If there is a table for you, the next process here is running. And basically, Luigi does or is a framework that makes use of directed acyclic graphs. That means you run the current or the most current task you started, and this task checks, hey, is this one here? Is this one ready? Ah, nice. Is this one ready? Nice. Is this one ready? No. So I have to Or basically, it says always no. And then, is this one ready? Yes, right. OK, I utilize this target. I start the next one. I utilize the target. I start the next one, and so on. So it basically traverses the graph from behind, from the back until it gets everything done. Cool. What we will utilize here is mainly the local file, because I'm working on a local environment. So the local file target here is our part. And what we are mostly using here is also Python task. And there's another nice task that we utilize. That's the external program task. Cool. Also nice. It's nice theory. We already know what we did in our interactive development. How would that map to a Luigi workflow, to a pipeline? So we just did a few lines of code, right? I mean, this is exploratory part. Yeah, we can throw that away anyways. We had this baseline model, easy. and a few lines of code. Let's have a look. How would our workflow look like? First of all, we download the data set. It's one task. The next one is we extract the data because it's zip file. It's one task. So we have already two. Create a processing, pre-processing configuration. Ha, is also one task. Probably, I have no idea how to do this because we are using an image data generator. Run the baseline validation, also a task, easy going, and evaluate the model. To me, this looks all, yeah, quite simple, quite sequential. Let's see how it is. I took the time and wrote it down, or sketched it out. These are our tasks, and it shows what task is depending from what task. And it doesn't look so easy anymore. Imagine you write this by hand. So you build your model, super smart data scientist, your boss comes and says, nice, we need that in production. And the operations team said, okay, build us a script that we can utilize in Jenkins, Bamboo, whatever you like, to automate it. You have to take care of a lot of stuff. You have to take care that you have this evaluate task. It needs this baseline to compare, and it needs the trained model. But it also needs the configuration. And we need to extract the data. We need to download the data. And baseline needs the data. Training needs the data. And they need the configuration. So we see we have a lot of interdependencies. If you build this yourself, it's a lot of work. And probably the first 3 months are full of bugs. It's as it is. Experience. Let's see how we can build this kind of things in Luigi. And for that, can everybody read this? Is it large enough? No. Better, right? Cool. Okay, let's go over the imports. So, we have task number one. We want to download the dataset using curl. What we missed in our image right here is, what do we need even more? We need a version, because we know the dataset is already versioned. And we need a location. Okay. Keeping the location aside, because I know where the dataset comes from, we name it and we version it properly. How can we do this? Our task overall, we were talking about targets and we were talking about outputs. We require nothing for it, first of all, because we want to download something and provide a target. This is basically our first, or if we run it in the end, our last task that we really run. Okay, our output is the downloaded dataset. Let's go through this a little bit. Wonderful. We have this class, download dataset, and what makes it really easy in Luigi is it's quite object oriented. So you simply inherit from external program task, and you only need to implement two functions in Python. So let's see here first. We get a parameter. The parameter is an int parameter. Default, it's the version. We want version 1. The next one, the dataset name. OK, just call it fruit, whatever. Here we call it simply dataset. OK. You will see, we go through it task by task, and you will see sometimes I write, we keep it a little bit uncomplex. You can get more flexible the more parameters you provide. But let's start easy way. Okay. And what we have here, we have an output. This is our local target. It's simply a file. It's our archive file, our zip. So that's the output in the end. When this task is successful, this one exists. And what do we have here? Our program args, easy going. We already have this here, the URL, all right. We built it from this base URL. It's the name and the version of the dataset. And what's here? Ah, yeah, we know this already, right? So going back. Here, we already used this curl. The only thing that we are doing now is we use it in a structured manner. It's inside Git, it's versioned, and if you like, you can even make it parameterized. Okay, what I'm doing. So, have you seen my... There, cool. So, this is our curl. It's in the Jupyter Notebook, it's one line of code. I think this is still for downloading some data, checking if this data exists, and probably not re-downloading it. I think it's quite a cool and small Python class. Let's do a quick test. I know we have no internet, so I already downloaded it. But you will see what happens. So this is how you invoke Luigi. Luigi minus minus module. This is the training pipeline. So just to tell you, I have this code in a Python file. So there's this one thing to show it to you. And I have also a Python file written, but it's not nice to show you. So it's exactly the same code that I just run now. OK, so we run it using TensorFlow backend because I do a global import. And what we see here, and this is cool, scheduled one task, one present dependency is encountered. And as I said, you stitch everything together using targets. And Luigi knows, there is already an archive for this version of the data set. I don't need to run anything. So I think this is the first part that makes this kind of pipeline already pretty robust. Okay, so we know this version that we run it with is already existing. We can check this. Datasets, fruit images, version 1. They are here. And the other part is in the temporary folder. Because we go to the next task. The next thing is we get an archive, and we need to extract this archive. So I like to compose every little part of processing that we are doing, I really like to put it into the most smallest kind of task. It makes these things way more or way easier to oversee and to understand. So the next part is also an external program task. And here we already see the next kind of feature. Now we have a requires. So what we require is that download dataset was running through successfully. And it ran through successfully. And if it does, what we get the input target back. That means we get the path, we get the file back that was persisted, the archive. Cool. So we have required download dataset version name. Output, again, this time it's a folder, but we will uncompress this part and basically push it here. Next nice thing, you don't have to touch any paths again whatsoever. Once it's done, you can always reference your input or your output. So you don't need to know where the stuff is lying. Also here, we have this name, we have the version, we return this output. The output is the input here, so it's basically really, really easy to stitch it together and reference the different targets and different paths. As you know, when you know the file is in that path, and Luigi knows this, you can simply reference it here. Okay, we unzip it. Let's run it also. Extract dataset. And again, did not run any task. You've seen the folders were already there. But these were the only ones. So the next things that we are doing, they have to be executed. Okay, now these were all external program tasks. There was no development from our side in between. What we need now is we need our configuration. And what I said is, look here, everything is done via the image data generator. As a pragmatic person, What I simply do is I take this image data generator, which is configured the way I want, and I pickle it. So I have a serialized Python object for that image data generator that I can load in every task I want to have. If it is a training task, if it is whatsoever. And you see here, no requirements at all, because we are now here. We had downloads, we have extract, we are now in configure. Configure doesn't need any dependency. Same as before, we have our local target, and what we are doing here is we create this image data generator. We create for our outputs, of course, so self-output make directories creates for you all directories that you need. For example, I like to version properly. Here it doesn't matter, but when we go for dataset versions, for example, we want to version dataset name, dataset version, actual dataset. So this is the way TensorFlow serving is working, and I prefer to work like Google works. So here we do the same. We create all top directories that we need. We create the image data generator. And if you're now saying, this is still static, it's fine, but it's sensier. I've written it down. It's for the sake of simplicity. Imagine when you build a really flexible system for image processing, you can basically every parameter you can add as a parameter into this task. I avoid this now, but basically what you can do is simply add the parameters into the task parameter and utilize these to create new kind of things here. It's also not versioned. The only thing that I've versioned here really is the data set, just to show you how it works. Okay, so we pickle it and we dump that down. Cool. Now the baseline validation. The baseline needs everything. So what we did, this is also nice because now it makes it at least unit testable. We already did this baseline validation in the exploratory analysis. Cool. So just move it out of the file or out of the notebook, put it into a real file, put it somewhere in the PyPI repository, version it also, so you got this part also done. You can have all your baseline validations somewhere in a nice repository. You can reference them via pip. You can even say, yeah, I want this version via pip, and you are done. In most of the automation parts, you are done. Versioning, reproducibility, you are done. This is also pretty nice because it's like a POM. You have a nice file with all the versions you have of your tools. So what we did is we simply cut it out, and we utilize this here in our task and run the baseline validation. What comes out? A new local target. This is easy going. And this local target is basically a JSON file containing the accuracy. Okay. Just see how this is baseline validation. Now we run this task. And you see here, now it gets interesting. And now the beauty of Luigi comes really in mind. Oh, let me make this a little bit bigger. So. Luigi scheduled 3 tasks. Why? The baseline validation, it was depending on configure, it was depending on extract, and it does the baseline validation itself. And you already referenced all of this information right here, because we say, oh, cool, I require the extract data set and the configuration. So in order to do the baseline validation, I require a data set, of course, and I require a configuration for my image preprocessing. That's the idea. And what we also see is extract dataset, we already run it, nothing happened, and therefore also the download didn't happen. But what was not working was the baseline validation itself, And this was now run. So this is already our pipeline. With a few lines of code, we basically tackled all these problems. We added versions to our data set. It's fine. The data set is just in a different directory. If you download the data set for version 2, it always starts triggering again. I will show you this. So what we did is we asked, now every time we start the pipeline, Luigi checks what's the least task that's not run and runs this. And then it goes back until it's there from the task, or it's at the task that you were triggering. Cool. So we have now a baseline validation. And if you put this into your, it's a simple Luigi command. And if you use this command in your build server, when you train a new model, and for example, you want to have a different configuration, you already have this automation. And instead of baseline validation, you can also write task, for example, to validate old models. And you pick always the newest model out of it. So what you build here, basically, with a few lines of code and a few requires right here, what you build is already what Google wants from you, right? It's automation, it's traceability. You basically archive all the models you have, and not only all the models, you also archive what did you use for these models. And that's the whole idea. And to be honest, from a data science perspective, if you know a little bit of Python, it's not so hard to transition your notebook code into this one here. Because most of the time, I'll be honest, I just use copy-paste. So, but this is here, this is the truth. This is the single source of truth. Every IPython notebook is fine for showing. It tells a nice story. But the single source of truth should be your pipeline. That's the idea. Cool. We have the baseline validation. We have multiple inputs. And after running, our output is a JSON file. All right, let's see if this works. Ah, see here, we have already a configuration. This is our pickled image data generator. It contains all the processing that we have to do. And the next part is baseline. Find a round object. Oh, JSON. Yeah, doesn't matter. And if we look here, it. Awesome. Can you read it? You see our baseline accuracy, just like we did it before. But now it's basically somewhere archived. As I said, it's not versioned, but adding the versioning also to the baseline validation is kind of easy. It works the same as you did for the data sets. It just bloats the code right now, and it's not worth it. Next one, we train our model. So I just used the same Keras framework, whatever you prefer, and have this model util where I simply define, it's the same code. It's the same thing that I do in my Jupyter notebook. And what it does is, it gets a dataset version, a dataset name, because it needs the dataset. That means we require the dataset task, and therefore get also the path to it. And the next thing, it needs the configuration. Well, we already thought about it, and we are here, train. It needs the configuration, and it needs the dataset, the extracted dataset. OK, and what does it return? I made it easy here. It returns an H5 file. If you use Keras, you have always some options. You can save this H5 file using a save model. What it does is it saves the model itself, the architecture, and it saves the weights. So if you don't like to do this, if you really want to use it, what I can recommend is save the architecture, the model architecture, and save the weights in different files, create different Luigi tasks for them, because this also allows you or gives you an easier access to reuse your model architecture and also to change your model architecture and basically retrain everything. But as said, sake of simplicity, We train our model here and we save the full model, full trained model. And same code as above. So you see here, we have a few parameters here. We choose the right training set. We set the epochs. And we start training our model. You know already the code. And if we start it here, so instead of baseline validation, we want train model. And the model gets trained. So it's already done. Just a little bit paranoid, but I'm check if the model exists, and it exists here. Cool. Even in a version, you see version 1. And this is already TensorFlow serving friendly. Sweet. So next, we trained the model. Now the evaluation comes. Evaluation is a little bit more complex. What we want to do is we want to check if our model is behaving as it should and if it's giving you a good accuracy or whatever metric you prefer. And if not, you don't want to go on. And if it does, you want to probably get to the next step, deploy, right? So, cool. First of all, now we require a lot. Evaluation, it requires the configuration. Because if I evaluate a certain kind of pictures, what I need to know is the data processing or the image processing beforehand. I need the right size or the right shape of the image. Maybe we do whatever image distortion or whatsoever. Or we do some pre-processing with OpenCV. We need the baseline. We need basically the trained model itself. And we need the data. This all is reflected in a few lines of code, requires extract data set, requires configure, requires baseline validation, and train model. And the beauty here is neither of these tasks will be executed because we already executed them for the parameters that we gave in. Okay. And you see here, you can easily get all the paths, all the things where you want to go, because you can simply reference these inputs. So we get the model path, because this is the... Oh, this is a little bit different from my code. I restructured it. you get the data set from zero, so it's I moved this around. I will update this. But anyways, what you get here is you get the model, you get data set, you get your config, so everything you need. We built again the generator, that one we pickled, we loaded it, we loaded again, and we run the evaluation. And now the cool stuff comes. As said, I'm quite pragmatic, and we load the evaluation, the baseline evaluation, we run the evaluation for the model, and if our accuracy of our model is better than the baseline accuracy, all right, we will basically save the result also in a good archived manner because we want to know what happens with that model, what were the results. If not, we simply raise an exception. What does it mean? Yeah. It means our task will be forcefully shut down and is red. So let's see. And we see this here. This progress looks... let me start it again and we see it better. This progress looks sad because there were failed tasks. And why was a task failed? There was an exception. The accuracy of 0.75 is smaller than the accuracy of 0.95. So we already have one thing that Google really wanted from us. I don't validate the model quality. So this is now implemented, even if it's simplistically implemented, but it's implemented. All right. And the cool thing again is what you see right now. This task, it will, if you trigger it again, it will be started over and over again, because there is no target that exists for this certain model and this certain data set that gives you a better accuracy than the baseline model. Okay. Now, let's run the whole thing, but with the different data set version. And if we have a different data set, that's now my flaw in this whole pipeline, it will generate a new model with new weights. So that means minus minus model version also equals 2. So we create now a new data set. It's already downloaded, but it would create a new data set. And it starts the whole thing on this new data set again. It trains a new model on this new data set. And just remember, the data set is twice as large. I'm always astonished how fast it is. So that's what we see here. It was running the baseline validation, it was running configure, extract data set, and we ran successfully evaluate and train model. And the task, the progress looks good. If you like, you can also have a look here. You see here, we have a new model, version 2. What we also see here, we have the evaluation in version 2. Have a look here. Text edit. It's since it's a two-class problem, we already have with two epochs an accuracy of 1.0. So we outperformed the baseline model pretty good. What happens then is you have basically, this was your gate, right? There is now a file, there is now a target that says, hey, look here, it's a better result than before. So, and with this, you can start the next exporting task, for example. So this is not implemented. I want to implement it, but it's supposed to work. So we have now a really good automation how to build models using pipelines. If we look into the file itself, the whole pipeline is less than 200 lines of code. It's all in one file. It's less than 200 lines of code. I think this is not too complex, and I think this is pretty much handled, pretty easy to handle from a software engineering perspective. And it's data scientist friendly. So the last thing is we now build our models pretty nice. And now this is a little bit the Keras and TensorFlow part. How can you deploy it? Now we come to the next question. How can you do canary deployments? How can you do blue-green deployments for TensorFlow models? Have you ever tried to serve a Keras model in a real environment using a real Python application? Oh, it's hell. You have to take care about threading, what kind of thread is initializing the TensorFlow graph. You have to take care about memory. Oh, damn it. And if you have no good storage for your model, you have to take care if you put 1.5 gigabytes of weights into your Git. Everybody really loves you after it. And so this is here the idea. Because we are working with Keras, this is the surprise task number 7. It's basically an exporter that is relying on the baseline accuracy. So if we know this certain model version is better than the one before or better than the baseline accuracy, what can we do? We can basically load the model, export it for TensorFlow or TensorFlow serving, and put it into the right folder for TensorFlow serving. So if you don't know TensorFlow serving, it's basically the Google module system platform to deploy TensorFlow graphs and their weights and serve them using gRPC. So I got some experience, or we made some experience with this, and it's really stable, it's really fast, and TensorFlow serving, and this is the next bit in the big picture, TensorFlow serving already has model versioning not heuristics, but model versioning policies. Meaning you can tell TensorFlow serving on startup, please keep the last four versions. If you get a new version, version 5, undeploy version 1, keep 2, 3, 4, and 5. And this is pretty awesome because I really like when you deploy models, I really like to keep the old model, the current model, and the future model. And you can simply or easily basically change your services to the new model step by step, see if there are problems, and as soon as all services basically migrated to the new model, the new model becomes the old model, you have another new model, and the old model gets undeployed. So, and here you are also one step more into automation, you are one step more into infrastructure, according to Google's paper. Okay, let's go a little bit through this. So TensorFlow serving, it's highly extensible, but it's as extensible as you are good in C++. So if you're not so good in C++, you can stay with the base version, and the base version simply tries to look up models in a certain folder that you tell it in at the start. So let's say our TensorFlow serving model. Ah, here's evaluate. What the? Export. So, what I'm saying here is TensorFlow serving is currently watching in the folder serving. And when I said we version already like Google likes to version it, TensorFlow serving, it does the same thing. You serve in versions. So you tell it, this is your model folder. This is your model version, and this is your model data inside that folder. And now what we see here, it's nothing more than a simple task that we had earlier, right? It's a simple Python task. Let's go a little bit through this, because sometimes it's interesting for people. It's not that easy and not that well documented how to export Keras code and Keras nets to TensorFlow. But before you start playing around, when you have a Keras model, use TensorFlow serving, and you deal with most of the problems you have in production running during your production deploy. So we load the model. What you then build out of this model is this kind of tensor info input and tensor info output. These are basically, this is your input tensors from the Keras model and the output tensor of the Keras model. And what's happening here is, it builds a Google protobuf behind it, protobuf file object. And TensorFlow serving is because you use gRPC. gRPC uses protobuf for serialization. Basically, all the TensorFlow serving code is based on protobuf for everything that you do with the communication. To serialize inputs, for example, NumPy arrays, you want to send them over gRPC to the remote machine. It basically gets serialized in protobuf and deserialized again. And when you got these protobuf files for your input and output, you can build this prediction signature here. Prediction signature means we have the input, output, and the method name, it's the predict method name. It's simply telling TensorFlow serving what kind of interface should it provide when loading your model. We use the predict interface, it's the most flexible one. There's also regression interface, but it strips you a little bit down to the loss functions and so on. So use the predict, not loss functions, but to the optimizer. Okay, so we got these signature constants here, prediction. We have our model version. Ah, this is still, as I said, this I have not coded this in real, just in another application, but I wanted to show you this self.model. So we have the model version here, we have our export path. We don't even need this one because the model version is in our export path. And what we now do is we move out, or we create a saved model builder, or create this as TensorFlow specific. The interesting part is here. We are using the Keras TensorFlow backend. And what we do is we pick the graph from the TensorFlow backend. So throw every Keras API away. We get the session, And we basically use the metagraph out of this session. We say, it's for TensorFlow serving. So we give this graph a tag, the TensorFlow serving tag. What does it mean? It means everything that you do not need, like a loss function, gets stripped out. Because loss is only important for training. So you strip it out, your graph will be a little bit lighter, maybe a little bit faster to execute. And we have here the signature definition. This is the prediction signature. This is what we put in here. With builder.save, we save this file. Now we added this output path here, meaning builder.save saves already into our TensorFlow environment. And we have an automatic, basically continuous deployment of TensorFlow models or Keras models. And this is the whole big picture. We have a really nice gated workflow. And as soon as we are better than what we define, we have an automatic deployment of the model, of the new model version into an environment. And this is for the big picture. You can use TensorFlow serving. You can use Spark machine learning pipelines. You can use MLDIP, whatever you like. As soon as you have a proper export function for your model, export to your environment, however this looks, you already have a really nice gated automated process to basically deploy new models automatically. And you already got a lot of Google topics covered, and your operations team will love you for this. Cool. All right. We have 20 minutes left, and I'm close to the end. I want to show you one more thing. Because what we are here doing is we are basically scratching the surface of Luigi. We know the components, we know tasks, we know parameters, and you already a few parameters, in parameter and the normal parameter, and we know targets. But how does this look in a different technology? I mean, we use all the standard stuff, simple Python things. And I want to show you something. We don't need this anymore. I want to show you one more technology, one more task implementation in Luigi that I really like and that makes Luigi also really usable for PySpark. Anyone worked with PySpark before? Awesome. Did you deploy, who deployed something to production? Okay, you know a bit then. cool. So, PySpark always baffles me somehow, because try to deploy a job to production. You have to take all the files from Python, put them into a package, deploy it there. Or you have it somewhere in the library, which makes then your whole PySpark cluster, again, environment agnostic. Not agnostic, environment dependent. And as soon as you have multiple clusters, multiple nodes in the cluster, you have to take care that everything is distributed properly. Long story short, you really go crazy. Cool thing, Luigi has a PySpark task. So a PySpark task, it allows me to execute PySpark code directly in my Luigi task. It also works with simple targets. It can also spit out a target in the end as output. And in the middle, you can basically run your Spark job, and you can directly code in Spark. So let's start here, and then the another part is the range daily base I want to show you. To run a Spark job, we can inherit from PySpark task. The cool thing here is you can directly inside your Luigi task, you can set the driver memory, so all the resources and the resource allocation that you need. And sometimes you need more, sometimes you need less. The cool thing is you can even say, I don't want them here. I want them as parameters. So let me give you an example. We worked basically with Azure, spinning up clusters at night, running a large task for, I think, 60 terabytes of data. So we were running this task at night, As soon as the task was done, we were persisting the data and we were deleting the cluster. So in the morning, we had no clusters running anymore. But what we did, now how can you spin up a cluster dynamically, but have always the same resources? So we have to find a way to also adjust the resources. And what we did is, we were reading the resources from a database. And the easy thing is, it's one more entry in the database. For example, if we reach the 120 terabytes of data, and as soon as this task is running, it was also acquiring more data already automatically. And I think this is a really nice and dynamic way of also managing your resources. And also, you look into the file, you look into the database, you look into a config file, and you always know how many resources does your cluster take. You see here, it works with the requires all the way. And here's the magic. We get the Spark context. We have the Spark session. So this whole computation here is running on your Spark cluster. And you can hack it right here. Or what you can do is you can simply put it out into a library, or you put your code into another file. You reference this file. You start it from here, still running in Spark. But no custom-made Spark jobs where you have to handle some custom deployments whatsoever. It can be done everything here in Luigi, and it's as simple as exporting to a TensorFlow model. And this is a real beauty. And the last thing, and then we have also some time for discussions if you like, that I want to show you is, have you ever came across the issue of backfilling? So you have a long-running data ingestion pipeline. Every day you try to fetch some data from a website. Yeah, what happens? One day it works, one day it doesn't work, then it doesn't work 2 days, and you have to run backfillings always custom-handed. So log into the machine, run the backfilling, put it somewhere, whatever, in the console, and have to take care that your data is still consistent. I did that too, and I hated it. So what Luigi gives you here, it gives you a date parameter, like our normal parameter, like our int parameter. It's simply a parameter representing a date. But Luigi is smart, and Luigi can work with it. There is a wrapper task. You can see it here. It's called range daily or range daily base. And let's say it wraps your task. This here is classify. It wraps basically this range daily base around it. And you can give it something like a stop. So it stops, for example, with this time here, it stops for the date today. And you say, run it for 4 days back, or 7 days back, or 30 days back. And what it does is, as soon as you run Luigi with this kind of parameterization, it will trigger this PySpark task for every day that you have configured in days back. You think now, shit, then I run this Spark task always. Now, not true. We have parameterized it properly, and we have targets. So what Luigi does is it sees, oh, on the day 7, already did it, I have the target, I can skip. Day 6, I can skip. Day 5, I have no target, I do it. Day 4, I can skip. Day 3, I have to do it. Day 2, I can skip. Yesterday, I can skip too. So you have really stable backfilling mechanisms inside your pipeline, if you do data ingestion, without really having to handle anything manually anymore. And this is one another beauty. So you see, Luigi is quite an impressive and big framework. It's close to Airflow and whatsoever. I mean, you can use a lot of them, Inter or whatsoever. You can pick one of them. They can do all the same, my opinion. But I really like the idea for structured backfillings, because data ingestion is one of the hardest part. Now the big picture also comes again. If you have to do a data ingestion for your model data, now you have also an automated way, you have a structured way, you have a versioned way, and you have a robust way of doing this. Exactly. So with the range daily base and this Spark task, we have 14 minutes, and I think I'm through. Any questions?
After everything you've shown, I'm pretty sure the answer is yes.
Yeah, that's a good question. Yes, there is. So let me show it like this. We use, for example, in this one here, we use multiple tasks. And you can yield, every time you yield another target, or you yield another dependency, a requirement, it gets executed. So what you could do is you can simply loop over, for example, the directory of all your models and yield another task with it. So that would be the quick answer that I have. It's always some kind, how is it structured on your code and how is your folder structure, whatever you are using. Maybe you use databases. This is one way. So if you know where to store it, for example, I know, we know here easily where to store it here in model. You can, for example, iterate over all the versions here and create basically a target per version. Then you have an evaluation per version, and if one is not working, it doesn't get over this kind of gate. This is even how the guys from Luigi recommend it, because you can simply return a generator for the models with yield, and this is how you spin up multiple tasks. So, yeah, you're welcome. Yes.
Are you going to share the presentation?
Yes, I will update the abstract on the PyData website tomorrow. I just want to clean the code a little bit, but you will get everything by tomorrow. In the abstract, exactly. There will be a link to the GitHub repository.
Yeah, thanks for the talk. So you oftentimes not only have a model version that you need to control, but you also have maybe the frameworks that are versioned. And does Luigi provide any failbacks or fail-safes for that you don't train on a framework version that you don't serve on and maybe the model breaks?
No. So that Luigi's, I know this, especially in the Keras environment, it's really hard. Luigi doesn't provide you any parts for this. The only idea I would have is what you can also do is, for example, you can version your requirements file for pip, and basically build all your steps above these. So that would be an idea. That is how we do it, but not using right now Luigi.
Yeah. Hello. How exactly is Luigi determining which tasks have to be re-executed? Does it simply look whether the target is there, or does it do something like timestamp lookup, like new make, or how is it doing that?
No, it does look if the target exists. Everything you do in Luigi is based on the target.
And does it look if whether a task has to be re-executed because?
Yes. Okay. Yeah, it checks. Is it there? This is one nice thing. As soon as when you use local target, and you use self output open, so target open, Luigi provides you a data stream which is atomic. It works or it doesn't work and it doesn't exist. So this is why I always use most often as I can use output open, because it's an atomic operation. It's either exist or not exist. Otherwise, of course, when you have corrupt data, but the data exists, you have a problem. Yeah.
Do you use Luigi's visualization web service? And if so, is it any good?
Yes. I got there something prepared. This is the Luigi server. I totally forgot to talk about it. Thanks. Okay. It just keeps a certain time in there, but there's also a history option. You can set it in the Luigi configuration that it keeps all the history of your tasks. Let me just delete and rerun everything except the data sets. So, because then we can also see what it is saying. I quite like it, I have to say. Files. evaluate. Perfect. So. You see here all the tasks that are currently spawn up. They're done. One task is pending because we are still training our model. I would say, yeah, now everything is done. So let's go to evaluate and look at this. Yeah, it doesn't look like much. So let's see what was hidden. Okay. So here you see what task is basically depending, and you can get some information. I don't like this view, and this is probably all you got already. But you can switch to this one, and this is a really nice view, I think. Because here you got also the metrics, yes? Yeah, because I already downloaded it, and I already extracted it. And what I did here is, Luigi only executes the least task that is not done. And I extracted it already, so it was checking, did you extract it? Yes, so it never goes to download. That's this kind of gates. Because I already downloaded the data. I did not delete the data right now as the files, the target files. But the cool thing is here, you also see how long every task took. So you have a really good overview about everything that you are doing, even on the performance part. So you have different workers. Important to say is the visualization. Luigi is, basically you have no central scheduler. You schedule your tasks using cron, and the task basically notifying the Luigi server what's going on. And yeah, if you go this way, basically, it also checks, is a task already running for certain parameters? So if you try to run a task multiple times with the same parameters at the same time, it will block. So just to know for consistency. Yes?
I'm here.
Ah, sorry. Yes, sorry.
thank you for the presentation. Very nice. If I understand correctly, there's no support yet for distributed execution of tasks. Is that right? Is somebody working on it? That would be a question. Mm-hmm. I imagine it's not a trivial thing to do.
There is an option for parallel task execution.
There is.
Sorry?
Distributed cannot be local.
No. That way not. You're right. The Luigi... Yeah, no.
It's not an active issue somebody is working on. That would be a question.
Right now, not.
All right.
Thanks. Because it's basically meant to run... The thing is, it's built for big data environments. Actually, the big processing, so we did it here now for TensorFlow, the big processing should not run on the machine where you run the task or the pipeline itself. So if you look, for example, for a Spark submit task, your whole Luigi pipeline is probably idling as long as you have your 24 hours long running job running on the Spark cluster. That was the intention behind it. Now I have to say, all right, for if you use TensorFlow, deep learning parts, basically the proper approach would be to also scale your model into, for example, Google Cloud Platform. Yeah.
Hi, I have two questions. One is, what if you change the code of a task? Does Luigi know that and know that it now needs to re-execute the task, or do I have to do this by myself by deleting the files?
Luigi doesn't know it. Luigi only looks on targets. It doesn't know if you change the task itself. So if you do this, and if you have good versioning, change the code of your task, increment the version.
Okay. And then another question would be, where exactly would Luigi be in my continuous deployment? Like, I have a Git repository, change something, and then a Jenkins comes, pulls the code, executes everything. Would this be run in a Docker container in Jenkins, or where would you execute Luigi?
This is how I do it. I build basically a Docker container with Luigi inside, get the code in there as my artifact, and run the Luigi inside. Because as long as you properly reference the Luigi server, they still connect to the right Luigi server, and you have the visualization or the alarming, alerting, whatever you need. But this is how I really would do it, because it also fits together, for example, with OpenShift Kubernetes to spin it up there.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
What exactly is the use of using a generator pattern in the requires function of each task?
I'm finished. There is none, to be honest. So you can either use lists or you use the generator pattern. The generator pattern is nice because it can dynamically create tasks. If I have a list, this list is fixed. It doesn't have to be fixed, but most of the time it's quite fixed. With the generator pattern, it's quite easy to simply yield new tasks that are that should be executed.
Thank you.
Can Luigi handle tasks that are running in different containers? For instance, because you need different environments or?
No. Okay. So the pipeline always runs in one container, but there is no mix. This is what I think the colleague also was asking. So the execution of one workflow in distributed environment is currently not possible. So it's always,
To clarify, even if it's on the same machine, but let's say that part one task has to be run in C++, the other has to be run in Python for reasons, can that be handled?
It won't work.
Okay. Thanks.
Any other questions? So let's thank the speaker once more. Thank you.